groups to be mass tested. Bahala na po ang nomenclature ng mga iba't ibang grupo. Mass testing po ang tawag natin dito kasi ibig sabihin natin, madaming Pilipino ang dapat nakakita kung meron sila o wala sila ng infection. And the goal there is to find out how safe we are in going around so that we are not spreading the virus and what we can do to ensure that we make our customers, our partners, and our workers confident about going back to work and about going back in public. So this afternoon po, sa Project ARK, bukod dun sa mga kakilala na ninyo, sina Claire at saka Sam na nagko-coordinate para sa amin, andito rin po si George Royeca. Siya po ay taga-angkas, isa siya sa mga core team ng Project ARK. Tinutulungan niya po tayo na buuin yung framework ng Project ARK. And then I'm here as the parang general coordinator sa buong project. And then between George and I, ikukwento po namin sa inyo yung mga different communities at saka protocols at saka mga procedures na pwede nating sundan para ma-implement natin ng ARK sa ating mga communities. So we are talking about community testing. There are two general communities in that definition. One is our workforce. So we liken that to being our own backyard. We want to make sure that our house, our backyard is clean. And if there is infection, we know what to do with it. And then the next community that is part of that definition is our LGU, the barangay, our neighborhood where our businesses are usually are located. So we assume that many of the people working with you live in that community and that you are interacting with that community. So with that, I summarize essentially what ARK is all about. And at the end of it, we want to make sure that all the tests that we're doing can contribute to the to government's test data so that they can properly map where COVID infection is. That way, we know where to go, where not to go, and we also know, and government also knows how to treat those areas where there are COVID infection. So George, you want to say hello before we turn over the floor to our guests today?
Magandang umaga po. Thank you, Jopin. So yun nga po, excited po kami i-present po sa inyo yung konsepto po ng Project ARK para sa community testing po na sabi po ni Ma'am Jopin. And hopefully po, we all work together so that we can really see visibility po kung ano po yung degree ng community spread sa ating mga empleyado at sa ating mga tahanan. So hopefully po, in this presentation, you'll find value in terms of what we're doing and support it po. Maraming salamat.
Right. Okay. So, Sir Mars, maybe we'll ask you to, and Attorney Jerwin, we'll ask you to please maybe introduce key members of your group and then your organization as well, so that before we start the formal presentation.
All right. I'll be the one to introduce the members of the group. Maybe the officers, only the officers who are present in the room. Mm-hmm. So, first, the organization is an organization of Socialized and Economic Housing Developers of the Philippines. This is a private organization representing the mass housing sector in the Philippines. So basically, our members are real estate developers who are primarily engaged in socialized economic housing. They are selling housing units within the price ceiling imposed by the government, which is not more than 1.7 million pesos. So in the room, we have our chairman of the board, Mr. Marcelino Mendoza. Also our national president, Engineer Jefferson Bongat, and also other members of the board of directors of the organization. We have Fernand Imperial, Fiona King, we have Charlie Tan. Also,
our vice chairman is present.
Also, our vice chairman, Ricky Siton, okay, is also in the room. Also, I'm rousing the participants.
It's a good attendance po, no? We have a lot of people attending. So, yeah. So far, probably you have what, 36 members and board members? Tama ho ba?
Our board member is about 15. Okay. But most of the people in the group are members, member developers from representatives.
There are chapter and from Cebu also, Ms. Fiona King, diba? National board member.
Oh, nice. Okay, yeah. That's great. Mm-mm. Sige. All right. So, sir, later we'll be asking you to help us moderate when we're doing the Q&A already para ma-facilitate, and then you will know who already have questions. Tsaka kasi we don't know people here. Actually, we do know one person. My sister at Filipina Women's Network, Miss Emma Imperial, is here.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
So, Emma, you want to say hi? Oh, naka-mute si Emma. Pwede unmute natin si Emma.
Yes. Well, I believe in ARK, and so I was the first one who really joined it together with some other developers. So, we brought Anchor Land and then other also BPOs. And I was very active with promoting it because I believe in it na talagang, to me, test, plus also the safety protocols, no, like mask and then washing of hands. So we're waiting now for our testing schedule because we have the medicines, we have the rapid test now. Okay. So we're just help getting it. And by the way, some of the ARK group gave us some tips. So we were able to hire doctor and nurse together with a lab person only for 16,000 for every 100 people. So unlike if you do it on HMO, you will be paying like 900 per head. So sabi ko, di ko kaya yun, no? So there is a way, 16,000 and you can test 100 people now with the rapid test. So that's it. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Emma. So, wag na natin gawin to. Nasagot na ni Emma lahat ng tanong. No. But we really appreciate it. Actually po, and you'll know this, no? One of the things, first things we ask for from the group is to assign a focal person. Because that focal person is included in the Viber group of all the focal persons of all the ARK members. Kasi doon po, merong active exchange of information. Nagtutulungan po lahat ng mga kumpanya doon. Kamukha ng sinabi ni Emma. So there's a way for us to help each other with free information, tried and tested activities that we've already done, and it makes it easy for the rest of the companies to follow. All right, so anyone else from the group who wants to say something? Sir Jefferson, baka meron kayong gustong sabihin.
I'm joking. Actually, the reason why we requested to talk to you is because, you know, most people now, diba, because of working from home, they're only focused on online. Diba? But if you look at online, kasi just too many information. Diba? Mm-hmm. Sometimes you don't really know which one to follow. So, that's why we decided it's best that we can get directly talk to you, clarify certain things, the purpose of the project ARK, and what is the real intention of or the results that you want from the doing the rapid test. So especially if you go to provinces, which most of our members are located. They really keep asking us, keep calling us, but it's really hard to answer, lalo na medical issue yan, eh, no? We're not really medical personnel or ano, even though we understand what is written, but the real medical implications of certain terms and certain activities and what is really going on right now with the pandemic, it's really hard to get the right information because although there's a task force, but there's still different implementing agencies. Eh? But sometimes those implementing rules are overlapping, or sometimes they cause more confusion.
They conflict. You don't have to be diplomatic. They really conflict.
Yeah, medyo, it's hard for us na, sa national as officers okay. side to answer din eh because apa not really housing related ano mm-hmm. so we are really thank you that that you gave time today so our members and us also as business owners and also as Filipino citizen can really understand what is really happening right now. Mm-hmm. So that's it.
Sige po. That's exactly why we want to be with you. We are trying to what you call this. We've tried, no? Since we started on April 23, that's when we officially launched Project ARK. We've tried to sift through the noise. Let's call it noise because there is really information overload out there. And tried to simplify a lot of things. And with the direction of our medical lead, who incidentally just joined us, Dr. Mingita, thank you for us. I know you're busy with your clients, your customers, so salamat po, yung mga patients ninyo. But anyway, I'll ask Dr. Mingita to speak in a little bit. With the direction of our medical team, led by Dr. Mingita, it gave Go Negosyo in the Office of the President, Presidential Advisor for Entrepreneurship, the confidence that we are in the right direction. I am going ahead of myself of the presentation, but let me tell you po, the moment Joey Concepcion met Dr. Mingita, and spoke with her and they discussed the protocol, test protocols, that protocol that Dr. Mingita and her team put together even before the lockdown. We found a meeting of minds po. Kasi March 14 pa lang po, kakasara na pa lang ng Pilipinas essentially, hindi lang po naman Maynila ang nagsara. Kakasara pa lang po ng Pilipinas so that we can keep the virus at bay. All of the business people were already talking amongst themselves so that we can find ways to help government, to support government in minimizing the damage to our lives in terms of health and later on in terms of our livelihood. Kasi po, at the end of this, paglabas natin sa ating mga kani-kanilang bahay, babalik tayo sa pagkakakitaan natin, di ba? Will there be something to look forward to after we're done with the lockdown? So that was foremost in the minds of the business leaders. And that was foremost in the mind of Joey as presidential advisor. So when he met Dr. Mingita and saw this, they married their objectives and we came out with the ARK protocol. So from April 23 until today, we've recruited more than 200 companies to be part of ARK.
And so Pin, you're frozen.
Uh-oh. Ganto po. I will stop my video.
Yeah, okay.
Hello, okay. So yun po. No? So since April 23 when we started this, we've recruited more than, or no, I can't say we've recruited kasi po ang mga kumpanya ang lumalapit sa amin and voluntarily asking, how can we be part of ARK? So let's show you now po. Sam, Claire, can we show our first slide? Ito po yung... Philippine ARK, hindi ito Noah's ARK, but we got our inspiration from Noah's ARK. We need to keep afloat during this pandemic, and we are doing it through Project ARK. So as of yesterday, about 1.2 million rapid test kits have already been ordered. Of that, 1 million is allotted for the employees, the workers and partners of businesses that will be screened through this rapid test kit. And this same companies donated about 136,000 test kits. Yan po yung sinasabi ko, hindi lang bakuran natin ang lilinisin natin, but also our surrounding areas. So before I go on, let me ask Dr. Mingita to say hello and say her piece. Ma'am?
Hi, everyone. Good afternoon. I just came from the hospital. I saw patients. Anyway, I'm glad to be with you this afternoon, and I can answer more questions later. No? And I was listening to Jopin yun ngayon, and I'm glad, no, despite all the noise. I think, you know, last night I was in Malacañang. I was invited to shed light also on testing for the president and some of his cabinet members, and Secretary Duque was there. And I think finally... We said, hey guys, we have to get our act together. We can't be arguing. We have to be seen as one. And finally, parang it's the first time that somebody lectured to them, really the way I lectured to them about about this, no? About what the testing is all about. Now, PCR and rapid antibody testing should be used in a complementary manner. It's not either or, it is both, no? All for the same end. So and then we all agree that we could do this for the LGUs, no? So that they won't be afraid to take their OFWs anymore, how we could use it, the knowledge for the OFWs, so they don't have to be stuck in quarantine for so long. You can actually use rapid test kits as an initial screening. There's so many things that we talked about last night. So finally, parang nagkakaliwanag na, no? So I hope it will be the start of some more unity and more harmony and less noise. No? So we can work okay. together.
Yeah, that's really good, Dr. Mingita. And it's good actually that OP, that Malacanang is very open to hearing from everybody.
Oh yeah, they are. And it was a very good session we had last night. Huh? Mm-hmm. Very nice.
Okay. Right. So let's show our poster. The poster that we came out with on April 19. Yan. Hindi po nagbago ang objective at saka ang protocol ng yung core protocol ng ARC magmula nung inumpisahan namin to nung April 19. The ARC first came out in the papers on April 19 and then we launched it officially on April 23. Just to clarify to everybody that ARC is not just about rapid test kit but it's a total protocol which takes care of it's a workflow. It's a whole workflow that protects the worker or the community. So at the time, I think everybody knows that in March and in April, we hardly had any capacity in PCR testing. Yes. So that was very influential in the way the ARC protocol was developed. We wanted to make testing accessible to all. We wanted to make it accessible in terms of one, testing will become available. And number two, testing will become affordable. So when you say make testing accessible, it's not just the availability, but it's also the affordability. You know, let's admit it. All of us in this room here, in this Zoom room, have to take care of the livelihood of many, many people, our workers and our partners. So we have that in our mind. So yun po yung rapid test kit, no? And then the ARC protocol, and as will be explained by Dr. Mingita later, shows that it can be a pre-diagnostic tool that will allow the PCR lines to be decongested para po hindi lahat ng tao nagsisiksikan sa ospital o sa mga laboratory. Not everybody needs to take PCR testing. There is the right time to use the rapid test kit. There is the right time to use PCR test. So we tried through the ARC protocol to make sense of that and laymanize it so that tayo mga business people, mga practical naman po tayo, will be able to figure it out. And also in that early poster that we had, which we still use today, the third and most important element of Project ARC is the test data. We give all of this free information and even medical advice to all the companies that voluntarily join ARC. And what do we get in return? Our currency is the test data. And this test data is something that we submit to government, to IATF, to DOST, and to DOH, so that government will have more reliable data to have a clearer picture of the real extent of COVID-19 infections, both active and recovered. Again, I remind you that when we launched this, we knew that the capacity for testing of the country, not just government, but the entire country was very limited. And this was our way of contributing in an affordable and sustainable way, data that could help government map that information properly. Okay, so it essentially po, if there are only three things that you need to remember about ARC, you know, our boilerplate is basically this poster. So now, as a business person, we usually ask George, the founder of Angkas, to tell us why he thinks ARC is important to him and to his constituents. So for the next few slides, I'll ask George to please explain that. George?
Thank you, Jopin. Jopin, I think that was a fantastic overview. Talaga pong ang ganda ng pagkasabi po ni Jopin in terms of ano po yung framework ng ARK at ano po yung objective. No? Alam naman po natin na lahat po tayo naghihintay ng vaccine. No? We know very well na hindi po natin matatalo yung COVID kung wala pong vaccine. So ano pong gagawin natin before that? And marami po nagsasabi, the vaccine is 18 months away, a few years away, a few months away, even 6 months po. But what do we do before that? Do we just lock down until such time happens? Hindi naman po pwede mangyari yun. So talagang ang objective po natin is paano tayo maghanap ng paraan upang ma-restart po natin yung economy natin, yung mga trabaho natin, yung mga negosyo natin in a safe environment na pwede po siyang mag-coincide, no? Managing and living po with COVID. And this is what Project ARK really tries to espouse, is that there is an ability for us to do this. How? No? Through testing, through visibility. Kailangan po natin makita na yung mga empleyado natin safe. Dalawa po yung pinapaalagaan natin. The first is our employee confidence. Kahit po buksan po natin yung mga opisina natin today at payagan po tayo ng mga enforcers at ng gobyerno bumalik sa opisina, marami po sa kanilang takot. Ako po, I have 30,000 bikers right now. Ngayon, less than 10,000 lang po ang lumalagad sa daan. Now, bakit? Dahil takot po sila. Takot po sila mahawa, takot po sila magkaroon, maiibigay po sa pamilya nila. So how do we manage that? How do we manage our employee confidence? No? Visibility is very, very important. And we need to be able to show our employees na talaga pong kaya po natin as much as we can, no, to make sure that we're able to identify those that have potentially COVID through initially yung rapid test. I explain po ni Doc Mingita mamaya yung antibody rapid test. And dun sa mga naging positibo po dun, i-isolate po natin yan for RT-PCR. Para ma-check po kung talaga po may virus sila at pwede po natin sila i-treat. Ang pinaka-problema po dun sa sinatawag po nating employee confidence, no, is that 80% of all COVID cases, and Dr. Mingita will expound on this later, are either asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic. In fact, 40 to 50% po are known to be asymptomatic. Ibig sabihin po, para pong tayo, walang problema, walang ubo, wala pong sakit, wala pong nararamdaman, pero potentially po pwedeng makahawa. So yun ang pinaka-problema po natin. And hopefully, if we're able to adopt this in a safe manner in our work environment, then mabibigyan po natin ng kumpiyansa yung ating mga empleyado na bumalik po sa trabaho. So yun yung first part po. The other part, I said there were two things po na pinapaalagaan natin, is yung consumer confidence. Kahit po i-lift yung lockdown today at sinabi po ng gobyerno na bumalik o pwede na po kayo pumunta ng mall, pwede na po kayo pumunta ng restaurant, pwede na po kayo mag-shopping or magtrabaho or whatnot. And this is what China has experienced, no, in their big cities as well. Marami pa rin pong takot lumabas. Marami pa rin pong hindi lalabas at hindi mag-iikot. And it'll take time for economy to go back to normal. In fact, hindi na po siguro dating normal, no, kundi tinatawag nilang bagong normal. So imagine po, meron po tayong dalawang restaurant. No? Restaurant A sa kaliwa at restaurant B sa kanan. Yung restaurant po na A, meron po siyang malaking sign, katulad po nakikita niyo dito sa screen, na itong establishment po niya has committed and is dedicated to disinfect their premises on a regular basis, to mask screen their employees po. And all of those things, no, social distancing, nakaayos po yung kanilang sistema on COVID versus a restaurant on the right side, restaurant B, na wala pong pakialam. Diba? Saan po tayo mas may kumpiyansa pumunta? So this is what we want to achieve. No? We want to do these meetings, we want to do this advocacy, we want to do this information drive para mapakita po natin at maturuan po natin yung mga ibang pribadong sektor, mga kumpanya na kaya po natin gawin to. Na kaya, meron po tayong way, paraan, para maging safe po yung ating lugar. No? As safe as we can. No? And testing is a major part of this. Now, that being said, wala po tayong hinihingi sa Project ARK na fees or membership or kahit anong monetary requirement. In fact, meron po si Ma'am Jopin na listahan ng mga suppliers ng test kits na napakamura po. Pero you can buy your own. Nasa sa inyo po yan kung ano po yung gusto nyong gawin, ano po yung mas madali po sa inyo. But si itong rapid test kits po, inuuna po namin yan kasi di hamak po na mas mura po siya. Yung nagsimula po yung ARK, nako 1,000 po yung isang test kit. Pagpasok po ng ARK, and as Joey Concepcion and as Jopin Romero pushed it po with the suppliers, bumagsak po yan ng 450 pesos o 500 to 600 pesos. No? Ang laki po ng diferensya. Ngayon po, si Project ARK is embarking on another challenge po to bring down naman po yung RTPC. Nakakasalukuyan po, nasa 4,000 to 8,000 pesos po bawat test. So really, ang talagang layunin natin is to make these tests accessible and affordable to everybody. Now, that being said, ang gusto po nating kapalit para po dito sa mga impormasyon at dito sa access na binibigay po natin para sa mga paraan matest yung ating mga empleyado at mapakita sa tao na tayo ay lehitimo at talagang committed, no, na linisin yung ating paligid at ating serbisyo at ating produkto at ating opisina laban sa COVID, dalawa po hinihingi natin. Now, Dr. Mingita Bagdilia later on will tell you what those medical protocols are, which is our first requirement. Follow po our medical protocols because our medical protocols has been vetted by infectious disease panel and the medical panel that Dr. Mingita has put together po. And when you follow those protocols, we will guide you in terms of how you can use the rapid test effectively and in tandem po with RT-PCR. Now, the second part of that po is a very, very important part is the data. So we've set up po for free electronic data capture method and also a manual data capture method that we can explain po. Now, may dalawang briefing po tayo. One is the medical briefing and the other one is an IT briefing should you want to participate and proceed. And ito pong data capture natin will be consolidated into the data warehouse po of DOH. And yung data warehouse po ng DOH na yan, kasama po lahat po ng ibang data kasukulukuyang ginagamit or nakukuha about COVID. So galing po sa public hospital, private hospital, LGUs, and whatnot po, OFWs, IATF. So we put that together, and then what we do, ano po output nitong data na nanggagaling po sa pribadong sektor, nanggagaling po sa aming mga barangay, is yung next slide, Sam, the next slide, please. What we want to do is map the entire Metro Manila, the entire Calabarzon region, and maybe later on, the entire Philippines. We want to map it out po para makita po natin ano po ba talaga yung degree of community spread of the virus dun sa mga iba't ibang lokasyon sa Pilipinas. Today po, naka-MECQ po tayo. Kung titingnan nyo po yung mapa ng Metro Manila, ngayong araw po na to, lahat po yan pula. Lahat po yan high-risk red zone. Eh, sa aming pananaw, baka naman po hindi talaga yun ang nangyayari. Baka naman po merong mga ibang barangay na sumusunod po sa social distancing, sumusunod po sa quarantine, na talaga pong maganda na po ang kalagayan at hindi na po siya high risk. Which is why ito po is very simplified. There's three gradients here, which is green, mid, and red. But it can be as many as 10 or 20, depende po sa gustong gawin or pananaw ng national government at local government po natin. But the idea is here, kung merong mga red po tayo na area, malalaman po natin sa regular po na pag-test ng mga pribadong sektor, pati ng ating local government, at pwede po natin i-realign or redistribute yung mga limited resources po of the government, katulad po ng checkpoints, katulad po ng enforcers, ng pondo para sa pagkain, aggressive testing, isolation centers. Marami po talaga nangangailangan ng tulong nila at malubha yung sitwasyon. At dapat po makafocus po tayo doon. At yung mga ibang lugar naman po na hindi na po talaga ganung kalaki or wala pong community spread or wala pong COVID, pwede na po natin i-relax siguro at magbalik na po tayo sa trabaho at balik na po tayo sa pagsisimula ng pag-push ng ekonomiya natin. So, yun lang po yung kailangan natin gawin. And hopefully, if we all work together, the data from the private sector is gonna be invaluable po. No? Ngayon po, nakita nyo po, meron tayong 1.2 million na test kits na po napapasok po sa bansa, yung iba nakapasok na po, yung mga ibang kumpanya nagsimula na po. That is 1.2 million people that will be undergoing this testing system po. So hopefully this is something that we can push, no, to get your commitment so that we can all help our government restart our economy once and for all. Yun lang po. Maraming salamat.
All right. Thank you, George. Sam, next slide tayo. In place of Gingay, I will tell you about what we're doing in the barangay. You wonder why we're starting with the barangay and not the workforce. Kasi po ang ginawa namin, we wanted to test our protocol in some communities that were ready. And since everybody was on lockdown in April and May, we said, okay, let's test it in the barangay because that is a community anyway that our business donors want to test. So the barangay is basically our area for bayanihan. So the test kits are donated by the companies. The ARK protocol is developed by ARK. And then with the help of the LGUs, who chose the barangays that we will be focusing on, we started doing the testing. So we basically put the testing where the people were in April and in May. So through ARK, we provided the protocol. We provided the forms needed in alignment with the DOH protocols. We also provided them with the training for their medical personnel and even for the people who are rallying the people, for rallying the test subjects for testing. And then also assisted with the handoff either to the isolation areas in coordination with IATF or to the PCR laboratories where confirmatory tests will be needed. So next slide, please. We'll show you some examples of this LGUs that we've already done. So you can see here, we started first with Manila, particularly Sampaloc. If you recall po, as we were about, or we thought that we were about to end the lockdown in April, we saw in the news that people in Sampaloc, Manila, nagsasabong po, tsaka nagbo-boxing sa kalsada. So sabi natin, oh no, mukhang hindi pa mabubuksan ang Metro Manila or ang Luzon. True enough, it wasn't. And worse, Sampaloc went on strict lockdown. Ni hindi nakalabas ng bahay ang lahat ng tao. And during that period, Mayor Isko gave us the go signal to do testing. And during that testing, we were able to find people not in the list of Mayor Isko and the barangay captains. We were able to find asymptomatic or mildly asymptomatic people who actually had the infection and who had the infection but did not know that they had it. They've actually recovered. And then these are the LGUs that we're testing, Makati, Pasig, Quezon City, and Antipolo, and more to follow. Next slide, please. Okay, so this is the summary of results of so far tested in this LGUs. As you can see, Manila is the biggest. Isa po yan talaga sa pinaka-cooperative na LGUs natin dito sa NCR. And then Makati was lucky because Dr. Mingita herself was the one who helped supervise that area. Quezon City, Pasig, Antipolo. So far po, total of 29,300 na ang na-test natin dito sa mga barangays na to or sa mga LGUs na to. And from there, we found that look at the categories for asymptomatic po yung mga walang karamdaman na nakikita, no visible signs that they are sick. But from the total number of 20,648 tested, 18,712 were negative, which is good. But IgG and IgM positive, 785 for Manila, 54 for Quezon City, 6 for Pasig, or a total of 845 something like 3.31% of the population. And this number is something that we wouldn't have known if we did not conduct this testing. So at least we know that one of our major objectives was fulfilled. And then all of this data now is being encoded or has been encoded and transmitted to the DOH through the Project ARK means. Actually po, medyo we have a little bit of a difficulty here because when we started, we did not yet have the digital channel to submit. We were doing this manually. And even now, medyo naghahabol pa po kami ng conversion of data. But when the companies started this week, at least they had the luxury of using the digital submission. Okay, next slide, please. This is a great slide. I mean, at least you see that. So showing you here po examples of the testing centers that were set up by these different LGUs. As you can see, these are not licensed laboratory. There's no need to do licensed laboratories, but these are all put together with the guidance of the medical team and following the ARK protocol. Simple lang po, mostly these are done in public schools because those are big spaces, or multipurpose halls because then they could the LGUs could ensure social distancing and enough space for everybody to feel safe. And then as you see here also, the medical team that is taking care of the tests or administering the tests are all in PPEs. So all of the safety precautions needed and in line with the medical protocols are being followed. Next slide, please. Okay, so let's go right down to the protocol. I think Dr. Mingita can put this in the best way and in a short way so that we can all have more questions later on. Dr. Mingita.
Okay, hey, Dr. Mingita Padilla here. So I just want to show you our team. I'm the medical head and I have a great team with me, Dr. Salante, who's infectious disease, a very eminent infectious disease specialist. And in San Lazaro Hospital, Esperanza Cabral, and Dr. Derit, who are former secretaries of health. And then a name here is si Dr. Jun Belisario, who's the Dean of the College of Public Health of UP College of Medicine. I'm sorry, College of Health of UP Manila. Okay, medyo hilo-hilo pa rin ako, ha? Sorry. Came from the hospital. Next slide, please. Huh? Okay. Next slide. Okay, the objectives of our protocol, when we first formulated it, and it remains the same, is to isolate and appropriately treat those with active infection, presumed active infection if you have IgM. Identify those already recovered and with likely immunity, that's the IgG. Use rapid antibody testing as a guide for contact tracing and monitoring of contacts, no, of active cases, and for appropriate quarantine and social distancing interventions, and to use the rapid testing, antibody testing results for identifying persons who may be fit to work. These are the IgG positives and those who are negative. So we use two methodologies. We use the targeted testing and also we use the community-based sampling. So first we go to the targeted testing. What do you mean by targeted testing? We don't test everybody, but there are certain people we need to test. And I explained this last night to the Office of the President, to the Cabinet, and to even to the DOH. Now, this is what we do, how we deal with, they ask me, how do you deal with the asymptomatics? And this is what we do. Next slide, please. Because we really believe there's growing evidence of asymptomatic transmission. So who do we test? No? Those who are probable and suspected cases used to be called PUIs and PUMs. No? Actually, symptomatic or asymptomatic persons who have had close contact with confirmed COVID patients. So these are family members, no, who live with the same person. Symptomatic or asymptomatic persons who have had close contact with patients who are probable COVID just waiting for results. As we know, we still have a backlog. Very, very lucky are those who have them done in hospitals like Medical City or St. Luke's, where we can have the results in 2 days. Unfortunately, for most places, it's weeks, okay? So they might still be waiting for the results, but then their contacts we can already test. Symptomatic or asymptomatic frontliners like healthcare workers, policemen, soldiers, delivery boys, factory workers, those who are involved in or need to have themselves checked because they have essential work, essential jobs. We also test, of course, all those who are symptomatic of COVID, because there are certain symptoms that sort of point you to COVID, no? Among them, loss of sense of smell, loss of sense of taste, no? Fever, the flu-like symptoms, okay? Then you have also sometimes, well, like difficulty breathing. When you have that, you should go to the hospital already. Don't wait, no? Okay? And then those who are high-risk patients, even if they're asymptomatic, like diabetics, hypertensives, immunosuppressed, no? There's a list of them that we also test in the community. Next slide, please. I remember here in our barangay, they were so grateful to be tested. You know, these people, the seniors and those who were, had many problems, no? They felt very good that they were tested. Now, once you've tested all those in the targeted testing population, we now go to the random sampling, which will be dependent on the population density and size of the barangay or the city or the district. And we leave it to our statisticians to decide on the number. We are currently very active now with a, sero surveillance study, no? With government and private sector to determine the real incidence of COVID in the community. We will be using some of this data for that. Next slide, please. Okay, I just want to show you a curve, not just a polygon. I just want to show you a very important curve for you to understand. No? This is the curve of the virus, IgM in red and IgG in green. IgM is the first antibody that comes into the picture once the virus enters your body. So the special action of quick response soldiers. No? So this is the PCR test. The PCR test detects the virus. It can detect the virus even before your symptoms come. Symptoms is day zero, symptoms start. No? Usually the incubation period is like 5 days average. So even before the symptoms start, mga 3 days, you can get the virus in your nose already if you do a PCR. So you can catch the asymptomatics, which is good, okay? However, there are also drawbacks because, PCR testing is not 100% because there are many human factors that come into the picture. One is the swabbing technique. Two is the transport of that of the swab. Three is the machine and how quick you run the test. Because if you don't run the test quick enough, then pwedeng mapanis yung sample and you don't get the virus as well. So based on studies, you can miss about 30% of cases even in symptomatics because of all those factors. Okay? Although, if you get the virus properly and you bring it to the PCR machine, it should be almost 100% as long as the virus is there. What happens in a PCR machine, RT-PCR, it's a reverse transcriptase polymerase chain reaction. That's the complete name. If there's a virus, in this case, it's an RNA virus, it reverses the RNA to make it DNA, then replicates it and replicates it and replicates it until it's read by the machine. Okay, that is the RT-PCR. Now, but so when does the IgM come in? The IgM starts to rise when you start to have symptoms. So we have patients sometimes who come to us and they're IgM positive. You can get them at this area. Okay, and sometimes they're asymptomatic. They have no symptoms, but if we catch it. So as long as you still have IgM, it's possible the virus is still there and you're still infectious. IgG comes in on the second week. It's detectable. So once you have IgG, you presume that the person is already recovered. Okay, so it's very important, especially, for example, I lectured last night, how do we use this for our OFWs, for example? Since OFWs are considered high risk, it's not the same as our quarantined population here. So it's major reverse. My suggestion was you test them first with antibody tests. If they test positive for IgG, let them go. Okay, because that means they've recovered. You don't have to quarantine them anymore. They're free to go. Instead of quarantining everybody, you know, not knowing and waiting for the results, you're wasting PCR tests. If they test positive for for IgM, or they test negative, that's the only time to swab them and wait. So that already And I gave them a lot of other caveats to do. No? Okay. So this is that very important. Next slide. Next slide. So if you're in a workforce, iba naman sa workforce, no? How do you use your antibody testing? If you test positive for IgG, as I said, even with the same as the OFWs, considered recovered, may return to work. Kayo naman, yeah, kayo may return to work. Sila may be freed from quarantine. If you test positive for both, the science now says even that is considered recovered, may return to work. You don't need to quarantine. IgM, even if the virus is dead, because your IgG is already there. Okay, if you're only IgM positive, definitely we consider you potentially infectious, acute stage. So we have to isolate you. Can you hear me? Yes? Can you hear me? Yes, okay. We have to isolate you. Now, there are two schools of thought, no? If you have no symptoms, DOH says you don't even have to do a PCR. You just isolate and quarantine and do a repeat after 2 weeks. And if they're negative enough for IgM, then and positive for IgG, you can already go to work. But many of us, we believe there's asymptomatic transmission, we still want to do our RT-PCR. But here's an option also not to, okay? Now, if you are symptomatic, regardless of whether you test positive or negative for your IgM or IgG, we also will not allow you to go back to work. We want you to be isolated and swabbed with the RT-PCR. Okay, that's one. Or just isolate for 14 days if PCR is not available. And then test again after that. So this is like a very simple matrix that you can use as a guide as to how to use your antibody testing in your return to work scenario. And this is based on Department Memorandum of the DOH 180 as well as 2020-200, the back to work memo. Next slide, please. These are just a list of doctors who are helping us to validate the various test kits and the different hospitals where they are being done. Next slide. Next, please. I think, okay. These are the PCR labs that have already been set up. No, because as I said, this is not just rapid antibody test kits. We do them in tandem, complementary. No? So these are the ones already set up. And then more are coming. And I think by the end of June, the target is to have 24 active PCR labs that can produce about 24,000 a day and bring down the price of PCR from what it is now to around 2,000 or less. So then after that, there'll be more PCR labs, PCR centers going to be set up together with various companies as well as the House of Representatives in many parts of the country. So it's an ongoing project. So we keep growing and growing and growing, okay? So I think that's the end of my slide, correct? Of yes. My board part, okay. Mm-hmm.
I think that's the end of our presentation and we can now open the floor to the questions from the group. Attorney Jerwin, maybe you can help us moderate because you know who is in need, who has burning questions and who you know who your members are. Sige po. So now we have, I think we have enough time. We have like 40 minutes for this Q&A. Yeah. Yes.
Jopin, I'd like to make a reaction dun sa sinabi ni George. No?
Sige po.
Actually, that's what I'm really glad that what you said about yun, confidence. Yeah, because I think that is the most important thing, the confidence to go about doing our business and going out and going back to normal, our normal lives, diba? But you know that it's not going away, even though if you find the vaccine, diba, people would get reinfected like any other virus. Actually, you get the info, diba? Who is really positive, where is really infected. Because I talked to some of our employees before they started to work. They really are afraid, diba? They really don't want to get infected because they know that it's really hard to recover and you don't know if you go to the hospital, nobody's going to take care of you. You know, so I really got that George mentioned that and that is what we really want to do now through our association is to get the information out. Diba? to get people's confidence, diba? And to get a clear data or clear view of what is really going on. So,
yeah. So from ARK, that's really good. So from ARK, after this meeting, we'll definitely give you a copy of the protocol. Pag-aralan po natin yon for company and as a group. Because it also helps if you remember, what's her name? Emma mentioned the economies of scale of testing. So there are companies like me. I own a company which has only 10 people. And it's not cost effective for me to have my own testing center. So I work with other IT or BPO companies and startups so that we can set up a testing center for our group. In your case, you are organized, so that's something that you can work on together. Pero of course there are big companies in this room, no? Maybe some of the smaller ones can cluster with them. Also in the packet that we will be sending you, we will be sharing what George mentioned, the supplies. Suppliers. So out of the 30 plus suppliers or that have been in test kits that have been accredited by FDA, our medical team tested as many as possible, did local validation. We asked for samples, mga 70 po yan, mga 50 to 70 pieces, and validating hospitals, 10 of them in the Luzon area used these test kits. And Dr. Mingita is the one, and Dr. Cabral are the ones dealing directly with these validating hospitals. So they are guiding us in telling us, oh, this test kit, you use it in this way. Kasi meron din po namang mga kanya-kanyang sensitivity or specificity. So they guide us in that. And those, that kind of information, bale, because we've already processed it, we will share it with you. And it makes it easy for you. Hindi na kayo malilito kung ano yung bibilhin ninyo. By the way po, no, let me point this out. FDA has 2 memos that it released saying that online sales of this rapid test kit is illegal. Why? Because these test kits need to be interpreted by a physician. We cannot just buy any test kit and then you do it on your own. And Dr. Mingita, I will repeat every time what you tell us every time. You do not diagnose the test, you diagnose the patient. That's why you need a doctor to guide you in doing this thing. So those are some of the things that we will be sharing with you para po dumali yung buhay ninyo.
So I'll start now. So the test should be done by a doctor ba? Or any medical professional can do it, like a med tech licensed nurse.
Correct.
I see. Okay.
What we do is we make sure there's always a doctor on hand, at least, not to
supervise, I see.
And to read, and to, because you know, and it depends on where you're from. Like in all the barangays we were in, there were always doctors in the group. Even in our barangay, we had volunteers, we had doctors and nurses who were helping. Okay, we had teams, and then even in companies. Those that have the company doctor, company nurse, they were able to do it. And we have also volunteer nurses who can be deployed to help you in your company. And then aside from that, there are now many doctors who have banded together and offer their services for testing, just for testing. No? And many of them are approaching Jopin to apply, you know, for to be recognized and to sort of tell us about their packages. Mga ganon, no? So, medyo, there are many things, there are many enterprising people now who are actually, they realize there's a need, no? And that's why that's happening now. Now, some malls will also offer it. I know SM is planning to do so. And I think Ayala malls as well. And then mga family docs. So some outpatient clinics are also going to start offering it. Although it's less expensive if you buy the kits and have a doctor do it for you or a nurse or a team do it for you. Okay?
So, Jervin, there are questions ma.
There is an advanced question post even before the forum, but I think it was covered during the preliminaries. But for the benefit of those who joined at a later time, they asked, how will the Project ARK proceed with the reported backlash coming from the medical community?
There's actually no backlash as far as we're concerned, because really, actually true. I mean, I can tell you that there's it's not a backlash, despite the statements, but there's no backlash to us, because what's happening is that every time people start bashing the project, we have more calls for people who want help. It has the opposite effect, actually. So we've never had so many calls as we have in the last several days. And we have appealed, you know, I've reached out to, because we know that Joey sort of got so frustrated now with all the continuous bashing. And he said some things which was, and he was quoted out of context by some media outlets, which happens a lot. No? So what we did is he apologized. And the spokesperson of the PMA, Dr. Oscar Tino, was very gracious enough. He also accepted it on CNN. He was interviewed and he graciously said, no, it's tapos na yan. We have no choice but to accept the apology and just work together. So I called him up and we set some sort of a meeting so we can see ways by which we can help each other. So that's how it should be, okay? And now I think more and more of the medical groups, because we told them our protocol is not, we didn't just take it out of the air. We also consulted a lot of experts. In fact, the ones I really consulted, we consulted, was the Philippine American Academy of Science and Engineering. These are almost 400 PhDs, MD PhDs, virologists, microbiologists, you name it, from around the world, Philippines, USA, Europe, you know, name it, around Asia. And these are eminent scientists, and their protocol is similar to ours. They also believe that we can use the two, because it has been shown in studies that if you only use the PCR alone, your chances of really finding the infection is like only 60%. But if you use it with the rapid antibody test kit together, it goes up to about 90%+. So there's really a complementary use, okay? So I told these people, we can disagree in peace, okay? But let's respect each other's interpretation of the existing evidence in science. So that's how it is. Like even lawyers, diba? Are you a lawyer, attorney?
Correct? Yeah, I'm a lawyer, yes. Attorney.
But lawyers, there's one law, but you can interpret it many ways, isn't it? So I said we can agree to disagree in peace and with respect. And the fact is, the fact of the matter is, there is a need for these test kits. However, we also agree with them that it's dangerous if you just let any Tom, Dick, and Harry or any LGU do it without supervision and without adequate knowledge of the limitations of the test. Okay? Agree kami doon. We agree on that. Okay? That's all.
Okay.
No?
Thank
I think
you,
that,
ma'am.
The issue came about, if you look at what the back end for this, that that's what I mentioned when we started, because there's some agencies and LGUs wants mandatory, di ba? They require the mandatory before you back to work. So para there's a backlash came from it, especially for smaller companies nga na, yes. Like Jopin said, you have a small company, how do you every 2 weeks you test everybody? Even for some of our members, it's really a very costly yon. There's still a debate now who would be paying if it's a mandatory. Is it the contractor or the developer? So I think it started, I think, from there with being the term mandatory, and nagkagulo-gulo na, we don't know really, mandatory ba talaga siya o hindi? Or do we really need to do it? So, but no. That's why there's confusion. I think that's
Actually, it's not mandatory. I think it's clear by the law. It is the decision of the company. Now, I know a lot of communities, for example, it's really mandatory. However, they're doing it because it gives them a sense of security. Like, for example, carpenters, construction workers who just come back to the community after a long time. Many villages, many associations will have them tested. But it's actually for the account of the community, of the barangay, or of the person who is actually building a house, for example. Or is it the contractor? That one, that's a gray area. Wala na kami doon. That's not ARK's, that's not our jurisdiction anymore.
Yeah, and to add to Dr. Bingita, no, we are involved in a lot of meetings with DOH, with DTI, with DOLE, because we want to know what they think about testing. Not that they ask us, are you forcing the companies to join? No, obviously not. We have proof that sometimes, you know, in a week, we have 300 emails unanswered because those are the number of companies inquiring how to be part of ARK. So, madami po talaga. And then, but what we're doing is educating the people, educating the agencies. That's why we're involved in the meetings with these government agencies. We want them to know that it is important to do testing. Eh, hindi po kasi nag-invest ang gobyerno ng maaga sa testing. That's why we're doing it ourselves. So, but in the process, we're not begrudging them that. Madami po talagang problema ang gobyerno. But to your point, Jefferson, we're asking them to stop issuing conflicting department orders, joint administrative orders, executive orders, and whatever order they are issuing. So, like, we were instrumental, for instance, in changing the mind of the Cebu cities, the three cities. In the early days, Lapu-Lapu, Mandaue, and Cebu wanted to make it mandatory for all companies to take testing, do testing before they are allowed to open. And not only that, to do testing in only designated hospitals, those that were designated by the cities. So we intervened in that, and that policy, or that intended policy, became just a figment of the imagination, or at least we're hoping it's not being implemented anymore.
But I think there's one LGU in NCR who will implement that. Eh. Yeah.
There are two.
There's one. I'm not really sure if they already amended it, but that's the policy they plan to implement, that they're accredited only the. Yung gusto lang nilang accredited, doon lang pwede magpa-test before they would allow you to go back to work. They would allow you though, but you have parang 2 weeks to do it. If you don't, within that 2 weeks, hindi mo nagawa, they will have to ask you to stop.
Hopefully, with the meeting of Dr. Mingita last night with Malacanang, that will be harmonized. So, dapat naman, no, it's the national policy, and then hindi mas masikip yung policy sa LGU kaysa sa national policy, di ba? So I think IATF is coordinating that with the various LGUs.
That's what, sana nga ganun na hindi siya, ano kasi, di ba, it's a virus naman, this virus throughout the Philippines, eh, hindi naman, that's not a really border. So sana isang policy na lang para hindi na kanya-kanya interpretation for different agencies or LGUs, because it's really hard, di ba?
Aldrin, I think, is raising his hand. Yeah, Aldrin Samson is raising his hand. Yeah.
Yes.
So good afternoon.
Aldrin, can you show us your beautiful face, Aldrin?
Okay, for a while.
Okay.
So hi, good afternoon to everyone, and thank you so much for taking the time to discuss more about Project ARK. I'm Aldrin Samson from Imperial Homes, and my question has something to do with the execution part. Just a background, we already procured testing kits for our employees, and we bought some for a chosen community. And then we tried to coordinate with our head office in the building, but they were not able to give us the permission to conduct the testing there. So we had to look for a facility. We got one in Silang, Cavite, one of our projects. But I'm just wondering if we can coordinate with the LGUs and request them to provide us a facility for the testing. Is that possible?
Okay. Cavite. George, you want to say something about that? Si George, expert namin yan sa LGU liaison. Eh. Friends ko lang maraming governors at saka mayors.
Thank you, ma'am. I think, sir, pwede naman siguro you can coordinate with the barangay, no? You may have to rent it, though. I don't know how they would. It'll be between you and the LGU, no, or the barangay captain. But ideally, what you can do, no, kung merong multi-purpose hall doon po or basketball court na covered po at open air, pwede po nyo gamitin yun. Eskwelahan din po. But eskwelahan is a little bit more complicated because it doesn't necessarily go. It's not necessarily under the LGU, but yung basketball court po pwede po. I think that is a possibility.
Okay, so we just have to coordinate with the barangay itself, and then maybe ask for the covered court.
Yes, barangay captain po siguro yun. Barangay captain o konsehal po nung area.
Or is there someone from Project ARK na we can also coordinate, let's say, ask them for help, let's say, for a location in Muntinlupa or Alabang?
So we are coordinating with several LGUs, we don't kasi po control the venue on the LGU side. Sila po nagpo-provide ng venue on their own. If it's an LGU that we are already in contact with, no, then I think we can ask naman the question, and we'll see what the answer po from that. But ideally po talaga you'll have to rent your own space if possible. That's the preferred route, no? Whether it's in the LGU or another location. Pero ang pinakamadali po nakikita ko would be a basketball court.
All right. Thank you, George.
Okay, sino po ang next na magtatanong? Attorney. Hello.
Let's see. For those who are listening, you can also raise your hand. You just click raise your hand in the upper right corner.
I have a question. Ako muna may question ako kay Doktora.
Okay.
Kasi somebody texted me, no? He's saying that they bought their own test kits daw. But I think it's not FDA approved pa yata yung nabili nila. Then, tinest nila yung isang employee na nag-positive siya for IgM twice for just using the same test kit. So what they did is they sent the person to the LGU for PCR. So what the LGU did is yung protocol na sinabi niyo, tinest ulit sa rapid test. Tapos nag-negative. So sinabi nung sa kanya ng LGU na ano is no need na daw to PCR kasi negative naman, and yung sa kanila kasi FDA. So paano daw yun? What do they do with that one?
Yeah, first of all, why did they use a non-FDA approved test kit? Because these test kits, I'll tell you, the danger of a non-FDA approved test kit, because our FDA is already being very lax. They will, as long as your test kit has FDA approval in the origin country, for example, Japan, Korea, US, no? Kung may FDA approval na siya doon, and it's a reputable country, reputable FDA, then they will accept it without question. Ministerial na lang sila.
Oh.
Under the, it's like a emergency use, okay? Then you just have to have certain requirements, like it has FDA in the country of origin. You have a distributor who takes responsibility. Ganyan lang eh, no? So, kung you cannot even get FDA in the country of origin, you start to wonder, diba? That's why hindi sila makakuha ng FDA dito. Now, this is what siguro those medical groups are also afraid of, no? Medical societies. And I share their apprehensions. Some test kits have very low specificity. They're very sensitive. They pick up everything. They pick up almost all antibodies. But they're not specific. So, if you test positive for IgM, it may not be as specific. It can even just be the common cold. You see? You understand? So, it's not specific. So, we don't know. I cannot make any judgment. Now, if this LGU used a kit which is more specific, okay, but less sensitive, so it's hard for me to make a judgment unless I know what kits were used. But I would really advise against using any kit which does not have FDA approval, at least.
Okay, the kit data is, I don't say, it's the LG of Antipolo. That's where they tested.
Which one?
Antipolo. I'm not sure what brand they use. But Antipolo.
Guys are here. Because originally, we did a kit which was not so sensitive. Then we changed to a more sensitive kit.
I see. So they have to ask kung which brand that they use.
Yeah. Pero okay. Is this person symptomatic or not?
Asymptomatic though.
Asymptomatic.
Yeah.
So you have also a choice. If that person, because a PCR can also be, they didn't do a PCR, no?
No, they did not. So nasabi kasi no need na kasi negative naman daw dun sa test nila.
Yeah. So then if it's asymptomatic and they're negative, then I wouldn't worry about it. Yeah, I wouldn't worry about it.
Someone was trying to ask a question earlier. I didn't catch her name.
Maybe our chairman might want to ask something, Mr. Mars.
Yeah. Construction is a little unique in the sense that we have workers that are dailies. So it's possible that they go to the site now, maybe the next day. Mm. They don't go working. Maybe they're working somewhere else. Then they may come back the next day, 2 days after. So what is your guidance on this, considering everything? Let's say the effectivity of the test, or do you have to test again?
Well, this is a very difficult situation. Like even in our own, where we live, no? And many villages, they have rules now for those who come in for construction. Because you cannot have them going home every day anymore. So the recommendation is for the contract, for the construction company or for the contractors is to house them already in the area where they're doing the construction. Because where will they go back? Cavite, Laguna? We don't know it, no? Do a test upon coming back and follow the guidelines we gave you for back to work. Then test every 2 weeks. That is the recommendation, no? Because that if you can afford it, then test every 2 weeks. That would be better. No? Now, of course, not everybody can afford to test every 2 weeks. It's not the one that cheap. No? Some people are small companies, as you said. So then in that case, there's no other recourse but talagang just social distancing, wearing a mask, etc., etc. Now, when they go home to their homes, you have no control. It's difficult. That's why the recommendation was to test every 2 weeks. Now, for example, our family driver, who used to go home every day to Taytay, I don't allow him to go home every day. He goes home every 2 weeks. So he comes home. When the first time he reported after the quarantine, since he's a medical driver, he was able to come back. I tested him now right away. Then stays 2 weeks. Okay, he was negative. Stayed 2 weeks. Then he goes home. When he comes back, he has to wear a mask again, as though he's a stranger. Okay. For a week, then I test him again. If he's still negative, he can take out his mask for another week. So that's what we're doing at home. So the two week rule might be a practical rule. Okay, that's one of the.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, thank you, Paul. Yes. Any other questions from the group? Okay. We have a few more minutes.
I'm not answering anything.
Rona
Abundo, she's calling. Wala na? Are you good? I mean, were we able to explain it well?
How do we, who do we contact ba? For if they, who wants to join the group and to get the test kits and who is the person?
Our point person for your group po is Claire. So Claire, okay, can help you. Oh, si Claire. And also we have an official email for inquiries, opae.ark@gmail.com. But anyway, in this case, you don't need to send that email anymore because what Claire will do is to send you the information packet. May Google Drive po siyang ibibigay sa inyo. Basahin niyo yung protocol. And then I guess the trigger will be when you say, okay, we're ready to go do it. We'll order from the suppliers directly. And then, anong tawag dito? You'll order directly from the supplier and then you set up your testing already. We also want to find out who your focal person is para ilalagay nga po natin dun sa group. So, yeah, yun lang po. And then when you start testing, we'll ask you to submit your daily output in digital channel.
Okay.
So madali lang naman po. So,
sabi naman the contact
ang mahirap actually siguro would be deciding on when to do the testing and how to set up your testing center. Tsaka kasi po syempre you'll have to appoint per company, for instance, if not per organization, yung pinaka-coordinator ninyo. And then, itatrain namin sila. Meron po pala kaming teaching videos, ha? So we have videos to teach you how to go about, si Dr. Mingita din po gumawa ng teaching video natin on the protocol. And then, we also have teaching video to use the data collection channel. So we have those materials. And then, you also will have access to the to the medical briefing videos that we had from previous weeks. So marami hong learning materials na pwede ninyong i-refer para matuto kayo.
Okay. Siguro, one clarification from Dr. Mingita. How do you really get infected? But through the nose ba? Or,
get infected, actually, there are several routes. There's it's aerosol. So somebody sneezes on your face, okay? On you, then you breathe it in to your nose. Or your mouth, the throat. Or your eyes. Or the eyes. Because coronavirus can be in the conjunctiva. That's why we ophthalmologists are actually one of the high-risk specialties because we touch the eyes. And it's been found in the eyes. In fact, conjunctivitis can be the only symptom of coronavirus infection. They found
it. Oh, kasama rin yun, conjunctivitis.
Yes, it can be. So, okay. And so there's three routes. But it's usually aerosol. So if I sneeze on you, and I have my saliva contains that, no? Or I touch my eyes, like sore eyes. If you touch your eyes, your tears, mm-hmm. you touch the hand of a person, the person touches their eyes, okay? And now, the problem is, it's not just sore eyes, it's coronavirus. So it can enter. But those are the roots, no? Okay?
So how about even whatever food, for example, the food is contaminated, then if it goes through your throat, walang ano siya.
It's not. You cook really... your food. It's the aerosol. It's floating in the air. Okay?
Air, but it doesn't
float everywhere. Like in the, no, it's not like that. You have to be a certain distance from infected people. So no need to be too paranoid. But if you're in a crowd, or if you're with, that's why now we say social distancing about 6 feet, so that it's beyond the reach of the sneeze, unless it's a very, very powerful sneeze. Don't you see me wear a mask, no? So it's okay, and then you also sneeze etiquette, as they say. You cover your mouth, or if you actually wear a mask, even better. No? That's why we wear a mask. Singing loud in a group is also bad, no? That's why singing in church is not allowed right now. Because the singing, as the saliva, will be floating around, and that was why there was so much infection in this church in Korea. Was their practices? Their practices were made them prone to the infection. So I sing in church, so I miss it, no? But it's bawal muna, bawal, no? For now.
All right.
Just a curious question, okay?
Yes. But just to tell everybody, you know, sana we'll have a ano parang solidarity photo before we end this session, no? So
yung mga picture tao, muna. Okay.
Before you leave, no? But go ahead. Ask sino pa yung magtatanong ng
jury na ta.
Ako, just a simple question lang. May ibang method po ba of conducting the rapid test other than the prick method or yung getting a blood sample from pricking your fingers?
Yeah, you can. You can draw blood from the vein, in the antecubital vein, like you would a regular blood extraction. Okay, this is for the rapid antibody test kits using blood or serum. So the prick, some test kits are quite sensitive that the prick is enough. Some test kits might require blood. So, and they'll say it's better. No? So there's also the venipuncture. Sa antecubital,
no? Okay. So, yung takot sa prick, mas malala yung injection. Walang
You'd be surprised. Some people prefer here.
Di ba?
Yeah, maraming ganun.
Okay.
Iba-iba yan.
Yeah, oo. So, and also the prick, doctora, di ba, you usually have a recommendation.
Yes, So, basically, I tell people, I'll just for the prick, make sure if you're going to use, marami na nabibili ngayon yung mga automatic lancets, one use, ganun, no? Sometimes you can use a pen and then just refill it. You use the deepest depth, no, of the needle, so there's enough blood. Okay, now you can warm it a bit, no? Then you can prick it. When the first blood comes out, konti, wipe it lang. Don't use that, okay? Because it has a lot of tissue, it has some debris, you know. Then you squeeze it just a little bit gently. That's the blood that you use, okay? Yan, mga tips, no? And when you use the rapid test kits, make sure they're not exposed to too much heat, because beyond 30 degrees, they'll be damaged. So between 2 to 30 degrees lang. So ako, I refrigerate them when we store them, when we take it out to use. In an air-conditioned room as much as possible, but since you're going to test usually outside, I have a cooler. We have a cooler there where we keep the test kits and we bring them out little by little as needed. Okay? Para hindi mainitan masyado. Yun lang, no?
All right. Sige. So I think if we can ask people to turn on their videos and big smile, we will have a souvenir photo. At least, you know, we're all in this together. We're going to try and get over this current situation all in. Okay. So we will have two frames, no? And Claire will be the one to take that photo.
So, yun naman, ano eh. Parehas naman tayo na ano kami naman mass housing. Ang okay. Pinapromote namin sa government to support housing.
That's very much needed.
That's why we, similar to your group, it's a private and then that's ano, working with government got to provide diba, mass housing for the yung
and sa affordable demand. Mass housing.
And affordable mass housing. That's a focus which is socialized and economic housing. So,
okay. Thumbs up po tayo. So, para ano, we're positive. We're very, very optimistic that this is gonna happen. Okay. Claire, cue us, please. You let us know.
All right, Sam, ready? First panel po.
Yes.
1, 2, 3. Another one po. 1, 2, 3. And then second.
Yes. One more. Thumbs up.
Smile. All right. Thank you. Thank you, Jopin.
Okay.
Thank you,
all right.
Jopin.
So, maraming salamat po. We created a group. Meron po tayong Viber group for this.